White Otter, the famous young war chief of the Ogalala Sioux, and his friends Sunbird and Little Raven, of the Minneconjoux tribe, were searching the plains for buffaloes. It was early spring, the time of the new grass moon, and the Sioux were expecting the great buffalo herds on their migration northward from the winter feeding grounds. Pretty soon Tartan Car will come, then we will have some good days and plenty of meat, White Otter told his friends. Yellow Horse is singing the medicine songs to bring the buffaloes. They will come. My father does that, said Sunbird. I have seen him do it many times. Your father is a great medicine person, like Yellow Horse, declared White Otter. Although the villages of the Ogalalas and the Minneconjoux were many days' travel apart, the young warriors visited one another with considerable frequency. The year previous, White Otter had accompanied the Minneconjoux on a great war expedition against the Blackfeet. Now Sunbird and his brother, Little Raven, had come to the Ogalala village to participate in the spring buffalo hunt. The three young scouts made an impressive appearance as they cantered across the plain on their speedy little hunting ponies. White Otter was tall and lithe. Sunbird was considerably shorter and heavier in physique. Little Raven was younger and less matured in face and stature. All showed the characteristics of the Dakota warrior. They were fearless, cautious, and crafty. Each had proved his courage and skill in a number of thrilling exploits, and despite their youthfulness, all three were famous warriors. They wore the simple dress of the hunter, which consisted of moccasins and buckskin leggings reaching to the thighs. They were naked above the waist. Their hair was worn in two braids wrapped with fur. White Otter and Sunbird, as chiefs of their respective tribes, were entitled to wear the coveted war bonnet of eagle plumes. Both had left it off to be as inconspicuous as possible in their search for game. White Otter, however, wore a single eagle feather in his scalp lock. They were armed with bows and arrows and flint hunting knives. White Otter and Sunbird carried fire sticks. Each was provided with a robe of elkskin which was folded beneath him, across the back of his pony. For 2 days they had searched the plains to the southward of the Ogalala camp. They had seen nothing, however, to indicate the approach of the great buffalo herds. Still, they felt certain that it would be only a day or so until the buffaloes appeared. When we see them, we will ride fast and tell my people, said White Otter. Yes, yes, we will be the first to tell about it, Little Raven declared enthusiastically. They were a considerable distance from the Ogalala village, and as the third day drew toward its close, they began to wonder if it might not be foolhardy to venture farther to the southward. They knew that there was a possibility of encountering both the Kiowas and the Pawnees in that direction, and the Utes from the west, and even their hated foes, the Crows, sometimes moved down into that disputed territory. The Sioux realized, therefore, that they were exposing themselves to considerable danger. We have come a long ways, we must watch out, White Otter cautioned. It is true, agreed Sunbird. The Pawnees travel in this country. Perhaps they are looking around for buffaloes. We must be cautious. They had stopped at a little grove of cottonwoods, which offered feed and water for the ponies. As the day had almost ended, they were tempted to spend the night at that spot. White Otter, however, decided against it. It would be foolish, he declared. Our enemies know about this place. Perhaps they will come here when it gets dark. We must ride away. It is the best thing to do, said Sunbird. They loitered until the ponies had finished feeding, and then they prepared to ride away. At that moment, a small band of antelopes suddenly appeared on the crest of a low ridge to the westward. They had stopped, and seemed to be watching something on the other side of the ridge. It was evident that they had been alarmed. The Sioux became suspicious. They watched closely. "Something has frightened Tartakadan," said Sunbird. "See, they are running down the ridge," Little Raven whispered excitedly. The antelopes were bounding down the slope. When they reached the bottom, they turned toward the little grove in which the Sioux had taken shelter. The latter watched them with considerable uneasiness. "It is bad," declared White Otter. "Perhaps someone is peeping over that hill. If those antelopes come close, they will find out about us. Then they will run away. If hunters are watching on that ridge, they will know that something is over here in this place. Perhaps they will come here to find out about it." "It is bad," said Sunbird. The antelopes were still running toward the grove. Several old bucks, however, had stopped to look back at the ridge. The rest of the band continued across the plain. They were running against the wind. As they came within arrow range of the grove, they suddenly stopped and appeared suspicious. They had caught the danger scent. "Tartakadan is sharp," laughed Sunbird. "The wind has told about us," said Little Raven. White Otter kept silent. He watched the antelopes with grave misgivings. Their behavior alarmed him. He felt quite sure that they would arouse the distrust of any foes who might be loitering within sight and tempt him to investigate the grove. The idea suggested disturbing possibilities. "See, Tartakadan is standing out there like a frightened old woman," he said irritably. "If our enemies are about, they will come over here to see what has frightened Tartakadan." "Come, we will ride away," proposed Little Raven. "Wait, wait," Sunbird cried excitedly. "I saw something peep over the top of that hill." "I see it," said Little Raven. "It looks like Maya Shush, the wolf." They saw what appeared to be the head of a prairie wolf rising cautiously above the top of the ridge. The buck antelopes had discovered it, and were flashing the danger signal and stamping nervously. "It is bad," White Otter said uneasily. "Perhaps it is Maya Shush, the wolf. Perhaps it is a hunter. We must watch sharp." As they continued to watch the ridge, the little band of antelopes suddenly turned and bounded away toward the north. It was evident that they had determined to avoid the grove. In a few moments, the bucks that had been watching the ridge canted after them. "It is good," said White Otter. "Now we will find out who is over there on that hill. If it is Maya Shush and his people, they will go away. If it is our enemies, they will keep watching this place." "Something is watching," Sunbird told him. The head of the mysterious prowler still showed above the ridge. It was boldly outlined against the fading sunset sky. It appeared to be the head of Maya Shush, the prairie wolf. The Sioux distinctly saw the long, lean snout and the pointed ears of Maya Shush. Still, they were suspicious. They knew that scouts often covered themselves with the skin of Maya Shush to creep up on game, and also to spy upon their foes without arousing distrust. "I do not believe it is Maya Shush," White Otter declared, finally. "It keeps too still. Maya Shush would move around. I believe it is a hunter." "We will watch," said Sunbird. "Look, look, there is another," cried Little Raven. A second head had suddenly appeared. It, too, seemed to be the head of a prairie wolf. The Sioux, however, were doubtful. If the distant objects really were wolves, their actions were most unusual. they were careful to keep themselves well concealed behind the ridge, and as the antelopes were a considerable distance to the northward, it was evident that the mysterious creatures were watching the grove. The Sioux were concealed in the timber, and there was no possibility of being seen. They determined to watch, therefore, until the strange objects on the ridge either showed themselves or disappeared. In a few moments one withdrew from sight. "That is bad," said White Otter. "Now I believe they are scouts. Perhaps one has gone away to call the hunters. We must watch out." Daylight was fading. Twilight was settling upon the plain. The Sioux found it difficult to distinguish the remaining object on the ridge. They felt considerably relieved to know that night was close at hand. "Pretty soon it will be dark," said White Otter. "Then we will ride away." They waited impatiently for nightfall. Their one fear was that a company of foes might ride toward the grove before darkness made it possible to withdraw without being seen. They had little fear of being caught, but they were anxious to avoid being discovered. Once seen, they realized that it might be perilous to loiter in the vicinity, and they were eager to remain until they found the buffalo herd. They watched closely until night finally came. Then they mounted their ponies and rode from the grove. "Well, White Otter, how do you feel about it?" Little Raven inquired, as they rode cautiously toward the east. "I believe we are in danger," White Otter told him. They continued across the plain until they came to a shallow ravine, which they had passed on their way to the grove. White Otter advised stopping there until daylight. "This is a good place," he said. "We will wait here and listen." They picketed the ponies in the bottom of the gully, and then they crawled to the plain to watch and listen. It was a long time before they heard anything to arouse their suspicions. Then they heard the dreary wail of a prairie wolf in the direction of the grove. Although it sounded natural, the Sioux distrusted it. Twice it rose shrilly through the night, and then it ceased. They were almost certain that it had been a signal. They listened anxiously for an answer from the ridge. The silence, however, continued. "I believe it was a scout," said White Otter. "Perhaps he was calling his people. Perhaps we will hear the ponies," suggested Little Raven. "We are too far off," White Otter told him. "Those people will ride easy." "Perhaps it was only Ma Ya Shush," said Sunbird. "Perhaps he went there to drink." "Yes, it may be true, but I believe it was someone different," replied White Otter. "We are in the country of our enemies. We must be sharp.